Tech. I'm Bob Tannenbaum, and today we're working on Module 2. If you then take out your Module 2 and open it up to the executive summary, the first page, this module is going to be dealing with business, how to set a business up, then how to plan it, organize it, staff, direct, and control the business. We're also going to take a look at the licensing law and what people can and cannot do as contractors. And then finally, we'll take a look at the Circular E, the Employer's Tax Guide. So I think you'll find this module interesting, and we'll start right on the first section, the first section being planning a business. Now, you're going to want your contractor's manual for this section. In fact, for the entire segment here, you're going to be working with the contractor's manual. We're going to start with chapter 1. So if I could open your contractor's manual to 1-3, which should be the table of contents for the first chapter, which is business planning and organization. And look over the table of contents, you'll notice it's again talking first about planning a business, then a few lines down it's talking about business organizations, then another few lines it talks about guidelines for a business, site selection, selecting the type of financing, preparing a business plan. And you'll notice about towards the middle, a little towards the bottom, there's an issue qualifying agents. We'll talk about that in its turn, but this is the link between the first and the second chapter. This is where the licensing law impacts the business operation in contracting. Then to continue on, it's going to indicate in this table of contents what other licenses may be required to operate. For example, if you're going to have an office, it needs to be in a correctly zoned area. If any type of your business involves affecting waterways and that sort of thing, there are certain permits involved in that. If there are any environmental issues connected with the type of contracting you're doing, there's also information about that. If you look down at the bottom of 1-3, you'll notice that it jumps from general descriptions about assistance and licenses back to the issue of a business organization and how to dissolve or terminate one of these organizations. And you're going to want to make that link, realize that the topic of business organization is split apart between what's at the beginning of this chapter and then what turns out to be at the end of the chapter. You'll notice now on your outline that the first topic underneath planning a business is a business startup checklist, and the outline instructs you to turn to page 1-6, so please do so. And you'll notice they've provided you with a checklist on starting up a business. Of course, the general idea here and the theory is that a good vision, a good business is one that has been very carefully thought out. This is true. But you don't want to get too caught up in this because a business is something that grows in the telling. So as you exercise yourself in looking at how to organize a business, you want to keep in mind that things may change once you get started. For the exam, though, this whole section of planning a business is worth perhaps one question. And it may be about what is involved in starting up a business. Topic number 2 on your outline is about developing a business plan, and it directs you to the page number starting on 1-6 and going through 1-10. It's describing this business plan and the process of a business plan. And you'll also notice that if you were to jump ahead to item 1-23 or page 1-23 in your contractor's manual, you'll notice that they have an outline of a model business plan here. So here again, they jump back and forth from locations, and they're trying to tell you that you should be running a very thorough projection of what you're likely to expect for several years, and that you also should have money set aside for yourself while your business is getting going. And they indicate that the business plan should run for 5 years and that you should have at least 3 months of income set aside to support yourself while your business is organizing. From a point of view of reality, my opinion is that you should be prepared to work two jobs, one to keep yourself alive and the other to grow a business. One of the biggest mistakes you can make in starting a business is to believe that the business can both begin, grow, and expand and feed you. Now, you may not be in that circumstance. However, as a general idea, it's a good idea to recognize a tremendous amount of energy is going to go into the establishment of your business. So the first section here, planning a business, is dealing with setting it up. Topic number three under the first section now shifts gears to the management aspect of running a business. And if you were to turn in your book to page 11, 1-11, you would see that they outline the major functions of running a business. They list them on this page: planning, organizing, directing, controlling, standardizing, assigning, and communicating. And what they're essentially setting you up for here is the recognition that running a business is a many-faceted activity. There are different parts to it, and you need to be able to shift gears from one hat to another as you move through this. And so that's the first topic, worth perhaps one, maybe two test questions: planning a business. The second topic in the second module is organizing your business, and your outline directs you to turn to page 1-12 in your contractor's manual, and you'll see that they're describing business organizations starting on 1-12, and this conversation continues all the way through 1-16, and then picks up again under item 1G in your outline, dissolution and termination, on page 1-16 of the contractor's manual. And I would like you to notice that as they go through here, they're going to list each of several different types of ways to organize a business. For example, if you look on page 1-13, they're starting by describing a sole proprietorship. And notice that they are giving you advantages to the sole proprietorship, and they are also listing disadvantages. Now, I'm going to describe each of these business organizations, and for the exam, you need to realize that the advantages and disadvantages are listed for you in this way, and you'll need to find your way back to this section if they ask you about a type of business. The first one that we just looked at is a sole proprietor. The sole proprietor, in many ways, is the exception to a number of rules, and I'll explain why. First of all, you are a sole proprietor. A sole proprietor means that you are your business, and this is its principal advantage and disadvantage. The advantage is it's simple and easy to create. You already are one. Yes, there's a formality you'll go through with paperwork, but essentially you are a business. The disadvantage, though, is that there's no separation between what you own and what your business owns. And so therefore, if something were to go wrong, you would automatically be personally involved in that situation. Furthermore, this type of arrangement terminates upon your death. And if your goal was to set a business up that you can then transfer to your children, you wouldn't be able to do that with a sole proprietorship. Now, the reason why it's an exception to a number of rules is because the sole proprietor is the license holder, is the business in construction. They're all one thing. So, for example, we know that businesses have to pay taxes, and to pay taxes, you have to have a federal tax identification number. So when you form a business, typically you fill out a form, which you'll find out is called the SS-8, I believe, and it has you apply for this tax identification number. And in doing that, you get a number for your business. But the sole proprietor does not need to do this because the sole proprietor's Social Security number is the tax identification number. So that would be an exception to the rule that a business has to apply for a brand new tax identification number. Another area that this comes into play with a sole proprietor is in the area of licensing law. In order to contract, one has to have a contracting company, and that company has to be allowed to contract by virtue of a qualifying agent. But in the case of the sole proprietor is at once the business and the license holder. So the sole proprietor does not need a qualifier because the sole proprietor is, in fact, the license holder and therefore is, in and of itself, allowed to do contracting. The second type of arrangement is a partnership. And in your contractor's manual, they are indicating those things that a partnership agreement should include. Now, keep in mind, as we describe these various businesses, that we're talking about things that exist by virtue of pieces of paper. So we're not talking about two people getting together, shaking hands, and then one saying, well, we're partners. We're talking about a formal relationship with pieces of paper filed. And this is very true on the exam. So if there's no paperwork involved and no formality to the process, then it's not a valid process within the context of these conversations. Now, the deal with a partnership is people get together in order to do business. So let's say three people got together and wanted to participate in a partnership. And a partnership is unique in that benefits flowing from the partnership are distributed one way, and losses are distributed another way. And you have to understand the distinction between the benefits and how they're distributed and the losses and how they're distributed. And if you want to practice doing some math problems, and the odds are you'll get a math exam about this on the test, you want to take a look at the CRAM workbook where it describes this process of partnership in the CRAM workbook. And that's listed at the bottom of your module in the section on CRAM, the CRAM materials that you'll need. But let's say you had three partners. Partner A invested $20,000 and partner B invested $30,000 and partner C invested $40,000, and they formed a partnership. And let's say this partnership benefits, it gains money. They wind up making $10,000 during the course of the year. Well, how will that $10,000 be distributed to the partners? Well, each partner will get a proportional share based upon what they contributed with respect to the entire contribution, their proportional contribution. So again, if we had three partners, one that contributed 20, one that contributed 30, and one that contributed $40,000, we would add all those up in order to get the total contribution. So 20 and 30 is 50 and 40 is 90. There's a total contribution of $90,000. And if we wanted to know how much partner A would receive of the benefit, partner A would receive their proportional share. So partner A put up $20,000, the total amount put up was $90,000, and so partner A would have 20,000 90,000ths, which would then reduce to 2/9. Partner A would have 2/9 of, meaning times, the $10,000 benefit. Now, on the other hand, what happens if there is a loss? Well, in the event of a loss, each partner is responsible for the entirety of the loss, and collectively, they are also responsible for the entirety of the loss. And so that is called joint and several responsibility. So if instead of making $10,000, the partnership lost $10,000, each partner would be responsible for the full $10,000. It's not that they're going to collect more money than what is owed. It's just that legally they have the right to go after each partner because each partner owes it individually, and collectively the partnership owes it as well. And that's the differentiation with the partnership. Now, that kind of an arrangement is not very attractive to a passive investor. You decide you want to invest in the enterprise that these three people are putting up, and you quickly come to realize that if you were to invest $500, let us say, if there was no other arrangement made, you could be liable for whatever the partnership lost. So that's not very appealing. So in order to combat that, there is an alternative, which is called a limited partnership, and that's on the next page of your contractor's manual. And in a limited partnership, it is set up so that there are two types of partners. You have one type of partner that are called the general partners, and these partners are in the same position as the normal partners in a normal partnership. They benefit in proportion to their investment, and they lose 100% of whatever is lost by the partnership. They owe that. However, the second type of partner is called a limited partner. And the limited partner is only at risk for the amount of money that the limited partner actually puts up. The limited partner cannot have any participation in management, but the limited partner is only at risk for the amount of money that the limited partner put up. So a limited partnership is organized with two classes of partners, those that are responsible for all losses and those that are only limited in that they're only responsible for the amount of money that they put up. On the next page of your contractor's manual, the next organization they speak to is a joint venture. And a joint venture is exactly like a regular partnership, except it's set up to do one deal. Now again, keep in mind, we are not talking about two people shaking hands and saying, hey, let's joint venture a house. I'll pull the permit and you do the work. That's not a proper joint venture. A joint venture must be a formal arrangement. And as we'll find out in the licensing law section, every enterprise that wants to contract in Florida must have a qualifier, and that's true of the joint venture as well. So that if you form a joint venture, it will be necessary to have a qualifying agent to qualify that joint venture for that one deal. So a joint venture is just like a partnership, except it's set up for one deal. The next item is a corporation. Now, a corporation is actually a legal entity, as is a partnership, and the corporation, therefore, can sue or be sued. It also can own things. It can have rights. And people form corporations for the first main reason that it does create a distance between themselves and the business. As a contractor, you may want such a distance between yourself and the business. You may want to be able to leave your business to your children, and a corporate vehicle would be a way to do that sort of a thing. And so one goes about to create a corporation for that purpose, and you create a corporation by filing the right paperwork and paying a corporate fee, which I believe is about $85, to the Secretary of State, and you get your corporate documents back from Tallahassee. Now, corporations are legal entities that are owned by shareholders, and when you fill out your corporate documents, you'll indicate how many shares the corporation is going to issue, and then your first annual meeting, you'll distribute the shares, and most likely, if you're a one-man outfit at first, you'll distribute all the shares to yourself, but it doesn't have to be that way. You could leave some of the shares back in the corporation. If so, that's called treasury stock, and you might want to do that because down the road, you might want to sell parts of the corporation to others or to investors, and that would be a reason for doing such a thing. Benefits from a corporation are distributed to the shareholders in proportion to the number of shares that they hold. So if, for example, you are a one-man band and you get incorporated, and now you are the president and the only stockholder, if for whatever reason you do not take 100% of your stock, you are not entitled to 100% of the benefit of the corporation. In other words, when the corporation tallies up how much money it makes, it divides that money up to the stockholders. If you do not own 100% of the stock, you will not get 100% of that distribution to the stockholders. The distribution will be distributed according to the stock ownership. Now, there are many different types of stock. There's almost as many different arrangements here as the human mind can think up. But for the exam, they differentiate between two types, common and preferred. And so you have one class of stock called common and another class of stock called preferred. And the essential distinction is what happens if the business winds down or goes belly up. How do you distribute the assets of that business? And in a corporation, the priority on the pecking order are debtors, individuals to whom the corporation owes money. The next priority, however, would be preferred stockholders, and if there is anything left, that would go to the common shareholders, and so that's the distinction there. Now, once you fill out your corporate papers and send them off to the Secretary of State and get your corporation back, it may become apparent to you that there is perhaps a difficulty, and the difficulty is this. Consider the Coca-Cola company. At the end of the year, what happens? It figures out how much money that it made. It then takes that money and it has a choice. It can do several things with that money. One is it could reinvest it back in the Coca-Cola company. Another choice is it could give a benefit to the shareholders of the corporation. It could provide a dividend. So you own Coca-Cola stock, and Coca-Cola stock is about to declare a dividend. But before they declare any dividend or finalize all of their bookkeeping, what does the Coca-Cola company have to do upon its profits? It has to pay taxes. So it pays taxes. Then it distributes the leftover money to perhaps the shareholders. And if you own Coca-Cola stock, when you receive that dividend, isn't that an income to you? Yes, it is. And don't you pay taxes on that income? Yes, you do. And so there is a double taxation on the same amount of money. To avoid that possibility, one choice that you have is listed on the next page of the contractor's manual, in my edition 1-16, and that's called the S Corporation, or the subchapter S Corporation. Now, this election, or this designation, occurs after you have your corporate papers, when you petition the IRS in order to be allowed to be a subchapter S Corporation. Should you win that petition and the IRS grant you that status, and what happens at the end of the year is, after you figure out your profits, the corporation itself does not pay any taxes on that profit. What happens is it transfers all the way over to you as income, and you pay taxes as you normally would. And so the money does not get taxed twice. There may be other advantages to the subchapter S, and for decisions of this nature, you really ought to talk to your advisors and get good advice on these subjects. They are important because they impact the benefits that you'll be able to enjoy from the operation of the business. Okay, so we have reviewed the types of partners and types of businesses that have been discussed here. For example, we talked about the sole proprietor, the general partnership, the limited partnership, the joint venture, the corporation, and the subchapter S corporation. And you can expect to get one test question out of this and possibly an additional test question of a math variety talking about the distribution of things either from a partnership or from a corporation. And then finally, there are rules about how these items end, should they be dissolved or terminated. And these rules are listed. in your contractor's manual on 1-37 and 1-39. The second topic under topic number two, organizing your business, is other business regulations. And subpoint A is the fictitious name registration. And if you'll take a look in your contractor's manual on page 17 in my edition, also page 1-18, it describes this fictitious name registration. And it doesn't really explain here clearly is when such a registration is necessary, and perhaps this will help get the idea. The whole idea here is that you must declare to the world how you're doing business. And there are circumstances in which this declaration occurs by virtue of your normal operations. For example, if you form a corporation, when you send that information to the Secretary of State, that becomes public record. And you, in fact, are declaring to the world who runs the business and so forth. But perhaps you're a sole proprietor, in my case, Bob Tannenbaum, and let's say I wanted to be a sole proprietor, and I wanted to operate in a name that was different than my own name. I wanted to operate as ABC Construction. Well, in that situation, I have not announced to the world who ABC Construction really is. And so the law says that I must do so, and to do that, I must fill out a form and go through a process called the fictitious name registration. The process is simple. It involves placing an ad in a newspaper for a period of time and then showing the proof of that to the regulators so that they can issue you the registration. You can contact any small newspaper if you wish to do something like this, and they'll tell you exactly how to do it. However, what you're doing in this process is declaring to the world who you are, and that's called the fictitious name registration, and it's good for 5 years. And it's really necessary in the case of the sole proprietor who wishes to do business in a name other than the name that he owns. It also could occur if you were a corporation registered under one name as a corporation and you chose to do business in another name without forming a separate entity to do business that way. Once again, since you're operating in a name other than those that can be researched in the public records, you must declare to the world who you are. The second topic here, topic B, other considerations, in this chapter on the contractor's manual, there also are exhibits and discussions of different forms that you might need for different purposes. There also is a discussion about where you might be able to get assistance if you wanted help or further information about particular topics. In the area of assistance, sometimes the exam asks about one organization called SCORE, and in your contractor's manual, that is described on page 1-35. SCORE is a pretty good idea. In the first place, you go into SCORE and fill out an application form, and they assess what needs you may have, and you discuss what needs you believe you have. And one of the services they offer is they will appoint someone to work with you at no charge. And that someone is usually a retired professional who has a lot of experience but wants to give something back to the community. You can get a lot of very good advice and mentoring through this process. For the exam, however, sometimes the exam asks about how SCORE helps in the process or the Small Business Administration helps in the process of borrowing money. And what you must realize about the Small Business Administration is it works just like the FHA. The FHA does not loan money, and neither does the Small Business Administration. Both of these entities are government programs that, in effect, insure loans if they are...